Welcome back to the channel, everyone. Today we're taking a look at an outdoor unit from Dr. Heater model DR238. The Amazon box used for shipping contained this box inside, which in turn contained this box, which in turn contains the unit packaged in styrofoam. So I hope you like cardboard. In this video, we'll take a look at this product's build quality, go over its light assembly, measure amperage at different power levels, install it in my freshly built gazebo, run over its functions and features, take a look at it with my thermal camera, and then finally render a verdict. So let's get to it. Once opened up, everything looks very nicely cared for. As previously mentioned, it was packed in tons of cardboard and foam, which is terrible for the environment but good for damage control. I particularly like that even the quartz tube covering the element has a bunch of individual foam brackets to keep it secure in transit. Don't forget to remove before using. Initial impressions on build quality are really quite good. It is all aluminum. We have some almost like a soft touch button there. We've got some tough plastic on the sides and then a metal housing around the heater element, which makes a lot of sense because you probably wouldn't surround this hot thing with plastic. For those, I know that you guys have seen my other videos, or maybe you haven't, probably haven't actually. But I'm just really big on build quality. Like when I buy something, I just like it to feel robust and I feel like that hits the mark. The remote, on the other hand, feels a little cheap. The buttons are soft touch, but it's super light and plasticky. It does not come with any batteries, so make sure you are able to pick up a couple of AAAs, or you probably have them sitting around. But yeah, I'm pretty excited to get this installed. I've been working on this outdoor gazebo project for a couple months now, and this is one of the finishing touches. Let's see, mounting brackets. We have four. See here. I'll have to get into why in a little bit because there appears to be only two spots on the back. So I don't know why there's four, but I'm sure we will figure that out in a moment. All right, so after taking a quick gander at the directions, what should have been obvious from the beginning was laid out clear for me. There are four because each mounting point requires two. Obviously, it'd be pretty tough to mount to a wall if you had a perpendicular mount like that. So add a second one. And now you're parallel with your wall. Everything attaches here with just some thumb screws, although the little hex nut here is a little tough to hold, so you may actually need a wrench there. Maybe not. It's pretty sturdy, actually. So let's head outside. All right, so one thing I wanted to show you guys before we actually mounted this on the ceiling was a little bit of ampacity. This has three levels to it. I know it's something a lot of people don't really consider, but when you're dealing with something that pulls a lot of amps like this, you should, especially if you're using it on a shared circuit or whatever, because you could pull a breaker if you're overloading that particular circuit. So let's just start it off on level one. And you can already feel it kind of radiating off here. That's looking like about 7.9 amps. Level two pulls that up to about 9.5 amps. And all the way to level three, that's looking like that's about 11 amps. So you know, if it's on a 15 amp circuit, you got about 4 amps there to play with. Hopefully the only thing you have going on other than this is maybe some lighting, because you don't really have a whole lot of headroom. It's really only about a 4 amp difference or 3 amp difference between low and higher. All right, as far as install goes, you don't have to be super precise with your bracket placement because they are adjustable on the back of the unit. So I've just marked out here and here where my studs are, and I actually went and got some different screws because I didn't love the ones that they came with. As far as wall spacing, they do want about 20 inches between the ceiling and the back wall. So I think I've got 23 here, so we should be good to go. I'll leave that a little bit loose so I can make any final adjustments once I have the heater attached.
What's really cool about this mounting system is that because they slide, if you loosen these up a little bit and you're not totally happy with the placement of this, you just kind of move the heater back and forth. Nice.
Up on the ceiling, and I think it looks pretty nice. We're not winning any design awards here, but it's clean and modern and should fit in with most decor styles.
So once you do have it mounted, operation is pretty much going to be via the remote control. You got a couple options here. The first one, it just turns it on and off. Up and down depends on what button down here is pressed. It defaults to just setting the level, so that's level 1, level 2, level 3. You also have a timer function here, which once you enter that, you also control it with the arrow. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Looks like 9 is as high as that's going to go. And then temperature, just once again, selects your level. All right, guys. Now, one distinction I want to make here is between a space heater and a spot heater. I'm not sure those are the technical terms, but that's what I'm going to go with. This is what I call a spot heater. I mean, we're outdoors and you really just don't get enough amperage or wattage out of a 115 or 120 volt household circuit to heat up a large area. But what it does do is make the area directly in front of the reflector actually pretty warm. So I'm on level 3 right now, it's going, and I'm whatever that is, 4 or so feet away from it, and it's actually very warm. However, if I just step right here, I can't really feel it at all. So the end goal here, like I said earlier, this little gazebo is a little bit still under construction. I'm gonna have a nice little couch out here, a little coffee table. So this should be a pretty nice area when it cools down a little bit. But you know, again, if you move a little bit off to the side, you're not gonna get a whole lot of benefit out of it. All right, so the last thing I wanna show you guys before coming up with some conclusions here is just a little bit of a thermal profile here using my FLIR camera. So kind of take a look here, just at the wall directly behind it. We'll see the wall itself isn't really getting warmed up by the heater. Again, kind of reiterating what I said earlier about this being more of a spot device. It's warming up a little bit. It's looking like a spot temperature there of about 96, whereas over there, oh, okay, it's 16. Okay, so obviously it is heating up more than I thought. Obviously there's the heater itself, glowing very hot on thermal. And what about the area directly above the heater? It's about 116. Feels warm to the touch, but doesn't feel hot or anything. The top of the unit, that's too hot to touch. That's looking about 250 degrees, but again, because it's black, it's not radiating very much. So up here, you can see my hand is just barely warmer than my hand. So yeah, that's fine. It's not gonna burn the ceiling or anything like that. So yeah, I would say from a thermal profile, we are all good here. Let's see if this can, there it is radiating on my hand. Kind of, I think it's because it's very emissive, it looks hotter than it is. But yeah, my hand is directly under it. It's pretty cool.
Overall, I think it's a great unit. It puts out a surprising amount of heat, provided you're in line with the reflector, and build quality is really nice. It's an outdoor unit, so hopefully big temperature swings don't affect it negatively long term, but since we're not doing a long term review today, we'll just have to assume everything will hold up. All in all, I'd call it a good buy.